JRay501 here. I'm in the Canadian Collaborative for Radiation Awareness and Monitoring, a community-based initiative. When you measure what you don't want to see, you just stop measuring, as if the problem goes away if you don't look at it or confirm that it is there. Here are some recent examples of the practical application of the willful blindness principle. After more plutonium was found further away from Fukushima recently, Japan will stop measuring plutonium now and raise the allowable concentrations to 1 to 10 becquerels plutonium. However, 1 in a million gram of plutonium causes cancer. After the release of a dense amount of radiation at Fukushima reported on May 8, 2011, evident in the highest spike since the disaster, a week later on EPA data on May 15th and 16th for Seattle, Health Canada stepped back its air radiation monitoring, moving from daily to weekly reporting. It now scaled back its radiation reporting to quarterly. Similarly, after forecasts of the radioactive Fukushima plume by the Norwegian Institute for Atmospheric Research predicted significant depositions of radioactive cesium and iodine on the northwest coast of Canada and America and beyond on May 9, 2011, the forecast could no longer be accessed at all as of May 11th. After the inquiry into one of the greatest salmon decline in history, the Canadian government intends to cut back on monitoring salmon stocks and letting go of 275 Department of Fisheries and Oceans employees over the next 3 years. Don't have to monitor it. Don't want to see it. After the largest ozone hole ever observed opened up over Canada this spring, the Canadian government now wants to take down, or is taking down, its ozone monitoring stations, which are a part of a global network, and lay off hundreds of scientists working at Environment Canada. These are illustrations not just of unprecedented environmental crises. These are illustrations that our democracy and its key values of freedom of information, freedom of speech, are crumbling. All right, well, let's go in and look a little closer at that ozone issue. This is the Vancouver Sun. Huge hole opens up in Arctic ozone layer, dated October 2nd, 2011. And we've got more on the story over here we can take a look at, too. The feds try to track the whistleblowers who started talking about this, the ozone monitoring cuts. They don't care that it is going to create a real issue. They're more worried about who told, because there's too many people, they can't cover it up. An image released on October 2nd by NASA shows ozone at about 20 kilometers altitude near the peak of the ozone layer in the lower stratosphere in late March 2011. Red colors represent large ozone amounts. Purple and gray colors over the North Pole region represent very small ozone amounts. The white line marks the area within which chemical ozone destruction takes place. An ozone hole five times the size of California opened up over the Arctic this spring, matching ozone loss over Antarctica for the first time on record, scientists said today. Formed by a deep chill over the North Pole, the unprecedented hole at one point shifted over Eastern Europe, Russia, and Mongolia, exposing populations to higher but unsustained levels of ultraviolet light. Massive Arctic ozone hole opened up over the Northern Hemisphere for the first time this year. The hole covered 2 million square kilometers, about twice the size of Ontario, and allowed high levels of harmful ultraviolet radiation to hit large swaths of northern Canada Europe, and Russia this spring. That was touted by 29 scientists. The discovery of the unprecedented hole comes as the Canadian government is moving to reduce staff in what Environment Minister Peter Kent calls the streamlining of its ozone monitoring network. Environment Canada scientist David Tarasick, whose team played a key role in the report published Sunday in the journal Nature, is not being allowed to discuss the discovery with the media. Environment Canada told Postmedia News that an interview with Tarasick cannot be granted. He is one of several Environment Canada ozone scientists who have received letters warning of possible discontinuance of job function as part of downsizing underway in the department. In Sunday's report, Tarasick and his colleagues say the chemical ozone destruction over the Arctic in early 2011 was, for the first time in observation record, comparable to that in the Antarctic ozone hole. It also highlights the importance of the environment Canada's ozone networks, which scientists have warned could be drastically reduced. Department officials say ozone monitoring will continue, but will be streamlined to eliminate redundancy. The Canadian stations were an absolutely key element of the network of stations we used to do the study, says co-author Marcus Rex of the Alfred Wegener Institute for Polar and Marine Research in Potsdam, Germany. Canada is the backbone of that network. The scientists say maintaining comprehensive data is critical to understanding Arctic ozone depletion and the threats it possesses. They used U.S. and European satellites along with ground stations and scientific balloons, including those operated by Environment Canada, to find and track the hole. The satellites, ground stations, and balloons each provide a piece of the puzzle, say co-author Kaylee Walker at the University of Toronto. It is important to have them all. The hole formed over the Arctic in February and March, then swung across northern Canada, northern Europe, and central Russia to northern Asia, prompting scientists to issue warnings this spring about excess radiation. Sunday's report shows just how big and remarkable the hole was and how it moved. It also points to what scientists are calling ominous changes in the Arctic stratosphere, about 20 kilometers above the surface, which may be linked to climate change and increasing greenhouse gas emissions. The measurements help confirm that chlorine-based pollutants in the stratosphere 18 to 20 kilometers above the ground triggered a process that chewed up molecules in the ozone layer that protects Earth from the sun's harmful ultraviolet light. Walker says it was exciting as a scientist to see the hole form, but sobering to see how humans are altering the atmosphere. Extreme and prolonged cold in the stratosphere last winter and spring sped up and enhanced the chemical reactions that destroy the ozone. Her group was monitoring the hole from using space satellites. Let's see. The spring hole clearly showed us that we don't have a good understanding of what the Arctic ozone layer will do during the next several decades. The email says UV levels were as much as 60% higher than normal under the hole this spring. The ozone layer recovered in late April and May when winds mixed the atmosphere, but the effects of the hole lingered for months. There was somewhat lower ozone over our heads this summer and higher UV levels, about 3 to 5% higher than we would expect if there had not been a hole. What about all the radiation fallout that went up over Canada? What about that? I'm sure that only added to the radiation exposure. I mean, that would kind of make sense to me. Anyway, So what they're trying to do is they're trying to get rid of as many scientists as they can so that they don't have to, they can keep the information that they are getting more private and not warn the world, let alone Canada, not warn anybody about what is really going on. And, you know, I guess they're not God-fearing men and women, although there are whistleblowers that are talking about it. And they're getting phone calls. And all they want to know about is who gave you the information? Who told you that? They're not caring about what they need to do or what they can do to mitigate this or, you know, let people know, be careful when going out. On top of all of this, we've got CMEs and solar flares shooting off. I mean, come on. It just snowballs and snowballs and snowballs. And there is no country on the planet that is not a part of this. And if there is, then we just tout them as being liars or terrorists or something else. When, you know, right now, this is terrorism coming from within our own government. This is terrorism to not take care of your citizens. This is terrorism. Blatant terrorism. And just straight up blatant disregard for humankind. How do these people live with themselves? I don't get it. Well, if anybody has the wherewithal, maybe I should have found Environment Canada's email address and phone numbers before I put this up. But I'm sure you should be able to find it fairly easy. I would jam them with emails. That's what I would do. You know, I'm in the United States, but the United States is part of it too. They're working right with Environment Canada. Anyway, just another going down the rabbit hole and finding out a little bit more truth. And instead of complaining, it's time to get busy. Start making some phone calls and start asking people what they're thinking. You're going to save money by not telling us that we're at risk. Alrighty, as always, God bless.